Right, people are coming in. Good morning. Welcome to the final day of the 2020 Charleston Conference. We're going to give everybody a few minutes to connect and get settled and get their audio ready to go before Anne starts today's session, the Long Arm of the Law keynote panel. Welcome. We're glad that you're all here. I see some good mornings in the chat. Yeah, the participants number is going up and up and up. We're glad you're all here.
Can they see us?
And good morning from Jim O'Donnell in the chat. Good morning. Okay, Anne, I think we are at 10:45 when you are ready to begin. We'll get Don with the slides and I'm going to mute and stop my video. So good morning, everyone. Take it away, Long Arm of the Law.
All right. Thank you very much, Leah. So my name is Anne Okerson from the Center for Research Libraries, and I am very happy to welcome everyone to the 2020 session of the Long Arm of the Law. Don, can we have just the title slide, please? Yeah. As many of you know, because you've done this before, we are now in our 11th year of this quite popular Charleston session, which we like to say is a kind of a serious legal topic session for information professionals with a bit of a light touch at the beginning and the end. And so our light touch at the beginning is with thanks to our guest star, Kenny Rogers, who unfortunately is no longer with us. We lost him earlier this year, but his songs live on, and we've kind of adopted his Long Arm of the Law song as our theme song. This is the story of a poor young miner who falls in love with the daughter of a rich judge. And the song is about the consequences of that relationship, shall we say. So what we normally do if we're in the Francis Marion Auditorium is the people on the stage, and you guys are off the hook this year, sing along as does a lot of the audience, or people tap their feet or so on. So we're going to have to do this virtually today. And Don is going to start us with the song and the lyrics so you can all hum along at home.
You can't outrun the long arm of the law. No, you can't outrun the long arm of the law. You can hide out for a while, he says with a smile, but you can't outrun the long arm of the law.
Okay, so I hope that got everyone warmed up. As I said earlier, this is a session of about serious legal topics, and you can see some of the ones that we've covered over the last decade. Serious legal topics for information professionals, librarians, and others. And let me just share with you who our speakers will be this morning, and I will come back and introduce them properly later. Our first speaker is going to be Nancy Kirkpatrick from OhioNet. Our second speaker is going to be Pam Samuelson from the University of California, Berkeley Law School. And then our third speaker in absentia is going to be Bill Hannay. We lost Bill earlier this year, just a few weeks ago, and we miss him very much because at the end of every session, he would write a special song covering the topics of the Long Arm of the Law session this year. There will never be another Bill, but at the end, Leah will lead us in a tribute to Bill Hannay. So the way that we're going to do this is we will have our first speaker for 20-ish minutes. Then we will have time for some discussion, questions, answers, whatever. Then I will introduce our second speaker, and we will follow the same routine. And after that, we'll move to the closing with Bill Hannay. So let me introduce our Nancy Kirkpatrick as our first speaker. I've only known Nancy for a few years, and I've come to admire her very much during that time for many reasons, some of which you will understand when you hear her speak. She's executive director and CEO of OhioNet, which is a multi-type library consortium based in Columbus, Ohio. She also has a consulting business. Previously, she was associate director of MCLS, the Midwest Collaborative for Library Services. Before that, she was director of library services at Marion University. And before entering librarianship, she practiced not-for-profit law. She was an ALA Spectrum Scholar in 2005 and 2006, and she serves our profession and its membership through relevant committees, such as the Committee on Professional Ethics and the Spectrum Advisory Board. She is particularly interested in change management, organizational development, and leadership models. And Nancy is going to talk to us today about the legal aspects, or a few of them, on the topic of diversity, equity, and inclusion, which is top of mind for many of us, so many of us in these days. So Nancy, thank you very much.
Good morning. Thank you, Anne, for that introduction and for the invitation to speak at this year's conference in the first place. I'm very honored to be here and very sad that we're not in Charleston proper. I always appreciate the hospitality that we receive when we're in Charleston. And on a selfish note, the conference is always, it precedes my birthday, so I usually come down for the conference, enjoy, and stay for a few extra days to celebrate. So I look forward to the time when we can all safely meet in Charleston again. I'm going to go ahead and try to share my slides and make sure that that works correctly. Okay. So, when Anne issued this invitation, she told me I could talk about whatever I wanted. And that was, frankly, maybe a dangerous proposition, as anyone who knows me well can attest. But as I was finishing up the prep work for this presentation, I realized that I probably overpromised in my description. My goal was to tell you about all the legal things happening related to diversity, equity, inclusion, accessibility, and anti-racism work in and out of higher ed and their implications for your work. And then I was reminded that I had 20 minutes to talk. So here's my compromise. I'm gonna do my best to get you up to speed on the case that I think seems most critical. And then I'll leave you with a couple of other things that you can read that might keep you up at night. And since I'm a lawyer, this absolutely does not go without saying, I am in fact going to say it. I am a retired member in good standing of the Minnesota State Bar Association, and I would like to keep it that way. So nothing I am saying today should be construed as legal advice. Consider my words the ramblings of one retired attorney turned librarian and part-time gardener, and nothing more. So let's start at the top, quite literally, with the executive order on combating race and sex stereotyping, which was issued on September 22nd of this year, also known as EO Executive Order 13950. Don't let the title deceive you. This executive order is not really about combating racism or sexism, but I'm getting a little bit ahead of myself. What is an executive order and why should you care? An executive order is, well, and I should say I was going to start this off with the Urban Dictionary definition of executive order, but Friday seems to be off to a good start so far, so I figured there was really no reason to go dark that early in the day. Fingers crossed for all the things that we're all thinking about. So an executive order, simply put, is a signed, written, and published directive from the President of the United States that manages operations of the federal government. Executive orders are published each day in the Federal Register and they're cataloged by the National Archives. If you're ever having problems falling asleep at night, I recommend that you pull up the Federal Register on your phone or your mobile device and start reading it, and it will probably very quickly help your inability to sleep. But there are some things that you really need to know. So an executive order has the force of law, like any regulation issued by a federal agency. But an executive order is not legislation. So no approval is required from Congress, and Congress can't just overturn an executive order. Congress can try to prevent implementation of an executive order, for example, by refusing to fund that order. But that requires a lot of effort, and it requires that Congress be in opposition to the executive order. And the only way that an existing executive order can get overturned is if a sitting US president issues another executive order to that effect. Right? That's pretty cool. It seems like a very inefficient way to get things done, or I should say it's a very efficient way to get things done, but maybe not the best way to get things done. Now, every president, sitting president, has issued at least one executive order. Some have issued many more. And prior to the last 4 years, very often these would be issued after lots of legal research was done, people were advised, and they were done in a very thoughtful manner. I will say that the current one, to my mind, has been done much less thoughtfully. Opinions expressed here are my own, but anyway. So going back to this executive order on combating race and sex stereotyping and why it matters to DEI efforts. If I wanted to read this to you, it would take the entire 20 minutes and you would stop paying attention partway through the first paragraph probably. But I have linked it there if you care to read it. And this order, I read it several times, despite my best efforts. This order is really a maelstrom of seemingly revisionist history and missed context. And that's just section one, the purpose. After sharing very specific snippets of history with no less than four references to heroic Black Americans and a declaration that we have made significant progress toward realization of our national creed, the purpose section then kind of goes off the rails into an ideological rant and descriptions of divisive concepts that are truly ironic. At its most basic, this order is designed to eliminate current best practices in equity, diversity, and inclusion training. Specifically, one cannot talk about unconscious bias or implicit bias, white privilege, critical race theory, or even systemic racism in a training about equity, diversity, and inclusion. And just to add to the confusion, none of those terms is specifically mentioned in the order. They're contained in a September 28th memo entitled "Ending Employee Trainings That Use Divisive Propaganda to Undermine the Principle of Fair and Equal Treatment for All," which gives some additional content to the original order. Who does this order apply to? It applies to executive departments and agencies, the United States Uniformed Services, federal contractors, and federal grant recipients, including universities and not-for-profit organizations. Now, there's a small exception to the divisive concept conversation. The order specifies that divisive concepts can be discussed in an academic setting if they're done in an objective manner and without endorsement. There's not really any more clarity given about what an objective manner means or what it means to endorse these divisive concepts. So frankly, it's about as clear as it was before, which is don't talk about this and it'll go away. There are several other huge problems with this order. It's added a layer of administrative complexity to the workflows for contractors. So there is specific language contained in the order that now has to be in the contract that the contractor is completing to be part of, if they're providing this kind of training. There's like a notice provision so that they have to post that contract. They have to disclose their information ahead of time, what they're presenting on. And the most problematic thing in here, well, not the most, but one of the many problematic things, is that there's a hotline that has been created for filing complaints. So if you're attending a training that discusses these divisive concepts and you feel any sort of guilt or shame, which is not allowed per the executive order, you can call a 1-800 number and file a complaint so that the person delivering the content is investigated. In the first 5 weeks that hotline was open, 140 complaints were filed as of October 30th. So this order I don't want to say it's a dumpster fire, but I kind of feel like it's a dumpster fire in the year that has been a dumpster fire. And when I first read it, my thought was, isn't this a violation of the right to free speech? Well, several organizations think that it is, and they've filed the class action lawsuit. Specifically, the NAACP Legal Defense and Educational Fund, the National Urban League, and the National Fair Housing Alliance have joined together, and they filed suit, a class action suit, on October 29th. And to quote them specifically, they called this order called it chillingly punitive censorship, which I believe it is as well, that violates guarantees of free speech, equal protection, and due process. Their complaint really is a thing of beauty. It is linked in that article on the left. I don't normally say go read a legal complaint, but it's so well written and it's not completely legalese that you don't have to be a lawyer to understand it. They start off by alleging that the order presents an ahistorical and counterfactual narrative that prohibits consideration of the structural barriers rooted in race and gender discrimination, thereby reinforcing and cementing existing inequalities into a permanent status quo. It also alleges that the concepts the president has deemed divisive are widely accepted, historically based concepts that have been used for years in trainings and programs across the country in corporate, public sector, and educational settings. So like I said, I would encourage you to read the entire complaint. The first 15 paragraphs of it are a really great lesson in history and case law with which we might all need to become familiar. And as a bonus, like I said, they're not overly filled with legalese. I can't make the same promise as you get farther into the document. But the first paragraph, again, was so strongly written that I think it's worth sharing. And frankly, maybe should be shared in just history classes in general in this country. Every nation's history includes unsettling truths that many would prefer to forget or deny. But true patriotism demands confronting the truths of our history, no matter how embarrassing or dishonorable, and undertaking the difficult work of learning from the lessons of our past in order to move forward. For the United States, that work requires reckoning with our shameful legacy of racial subjugation of Black people in this country, from slavery and Jim Crow to mass incarceration and police violence, as well as our long history of express discrimination against other people of color, women, and LGBTQ persons. It's too early to speculate about outcomes, clearly, since this case was just filed a little over a week ago, but I am really encouraged by the strength of the arguments. In simple terms, they contend that the order violates freedom of speech, the Equal Protection Clause, and should be voided for vagueness per the Fifth Amendment. And in the absence of an executive order abolishing this one, I hope they get their day in court, and I wish them Godspeed. The Labor Department is also investigating Microsoft. So this doesn't just have implications for federal agencies. It's also affecting, like we said, not-for-profits. It's affecting the private industry as well, unless you think they're somehow exempt. Specifically, they're questioning whether Microsoft's stated goal of increasing Black representation in its organizations is a Civil Rights Act violation. Think about that for a minute. Microsoft wants to increase Black representation in their organization, and this administration is claiming that could be a Civil Rights Act violation. I almost can't say it with a straight face. Microsoft says it believes it is complying with all applicable laws in response to the investigation by the Office of Federal Contract Compliance Programs, or the OFCCP. And their response so far is really best summed up here. We look forward to helping the OFCCP understand the legality of our programs as we work towards a shared goal of promoting diversity in full conformity with federal law. Additionally, Microsoft Corporate Vice President and General Counsel Dev Stahlkopf has said that the company knows full well how to appropriately create opportunities for people without taking away opportunities from others, and has said that it's prepared to defend its approach. And then I also wanted to share with you libraries' response to this. The American Library Association has come out with a really strong statement opposing the executive order. In part, they state, this order is based on patently false and malicious claims that diversity training, which is aimed at fostering a more equitable and just workplace and dismantling systemic racism and sexism, reflects a Marxist doctrine that is itself racist and sexist. The American Library Association rejects this claim. They go on to say, We are reminded of another time and another era when the Council of the American Library Association adopted the Freedom to Read statement in response to growing concerns about censorship in the McCarthy era. That statement reads in part, "Totalitarian systems attempt to maintain themselves in power by the ruthless suppression of any concept that challenges the established orthodoxy. The power of a democratic system to adapt to change is vastly strengthened by the freedom of its citizens to choose widely from among conflicting opinions offered freely to them. To stifle every nonconformist idea at birth would mark the end of the democratic process." One last thing I would say, because we don't know what has happened yet with the 2020 presidential election, there is some hope that this executive order will go away very quickly in 2021, but we don't know if that will happen. The Biden campaign declined to say whether he would rescind the order, saying instead, "Vice President Biden stands firmly against discrimination of all kinds, and his administration will tackle systemic racism and other forms of discrimination across all of our laws, policies, and institutions." So for the time being, this order is law, has the force of law, and could be affecting the way that you do work. And in fact, I know that it has been affecting the way some libraries have been doing work. So what should you do at your institution if you want to conduct a DEI training being provided by a federal contractor? Chances are, if you had one of those trainings scheduled, it's already been canceled or postponed due to this order. So there's probably nothing to do at the moment. But if you are providing a training yourselves that is funded in any way by a federal grant, I think my best advice would be to maybe pause what you're doing, speak to your general counsel, and make sure that you are in compliance with the letter of the law of this order until, as long as this order exists. So I know that time is short today, so that most of my time obviously was spent talking about that because I think it's really the biggest threat to DEI training right now, whether or not you are work for the federal government or whether or not you think this applies to you, it very likely does. So, but there are a few other cases out there that I think are worth mentioning. And so I have linked to those here. So pay discrimination lawsuits in academia. I look forward to a day, which I don't believe will happen in my lifetime, when men and women are paid equally for the work that they do. But in the meantime, right now, there's been some lawsuits that are suggesting that really little progress is being made for women in this area. And so women are generally still paid, what, about $76 or 76 cents for every dollar that a man is paid. And that actually specifically is white women. Women of color are actually paid, it's more like 65 cents, so we're paid even less. And that issue is not going away. And I feel like it's something that academia could step up and just do something about if it mattered to them. There are many, many lawsuits because of COVID-19. So there are students suing over tuition refunds and housing deposits and that kind of thing. There are students who are suing because they feel like the online education they're getting is not comparable to the education that they were getting in person. And so linked there is a list of over 70 universities currently being sued following campus closures and a little bit of a summary of each case that's happening. And then higher ed and the election. There was a really great piece in the Chronicle of Higher Ed where scholars and academic leaders responded to the election and its implications for us. And it's across a breadth of topics. It represents a variety of viewpoints. And I found it to be very interesting. And then because I didn't really want to leave you unable to sleep at night, I included a link to some good news because again, while we might get good news later today, fingers crossed. In the meantime, while we wait for that, there is other good news happening in the world and I didn't want to leave you in an existential crisis as the end of my keynote. So check out that link if you need to smile. And with that, we can open it up for discussion while we have a few minutes, and I'm going to stop sharing my screen so I can see all of your lovely faces.
There, I remembered to unmute myself. Thank you, Nancy. there aren't enough words to, in our time slot or any time slot, to really do justice to this topic, but you have raised a number of questions and comments with people in the audience. So why don't we try to get through some of those? Somebody did ask, and I think you've answered this, what advice do you give to universities and libraries that have canceled or are going to cancel their programs? And you have, I thought that was interesting. You've advised us to be very cautious in this area. Is there any reason to not be cautious?
I think you need to be cautious, because if you rely on federal funding right now, that could be a threat if you do this wrong. And so I would like to say, be brave, do it anyway, risk the consequences. So I guess I would say, if your legal coffers are such that you can defend, that you're willing to defend that, then you should, but not everybody has the ability to do that. I was thinking specifically of our, many of our OhioNet libraries are very small academic libraries where, you know, we've got institutions with an FTE of, you know, 300, and they don't have the financial resources necessarily to mount a strong defense to that. But so unfortunately, I'm going to say be careful for now, but I'm going to be optimistic that perhaps early in 2021, this will be less threatening. The other thing that I would love to see, although I hate that it has to happen this way, is I would love to see a clever somebody who does the DEI training now find a way to write their training in such a way that it is effective, but doesn't use any of the offensive words that are sort of mandated that we can't use. I feel like there's got to be a way to do that and still get the point across, but it's going to take a lot of work. And these are issues that we need to be addressing now instead of, you know, putting off. So it's a challenge. I know it's not a perfect answer, but it's the answer.
Someone has asked, and I'm not familiar with Title IX, but someone has asked about Title IX training at a state-supported university. What about that?
Ooh. I am not as familiar with Title IX as I should be either. So I don't want to give a wrong answer. I would say there's got to be somebody at their school who, again, in that office or in their general counsel, who probably is better versed to answer this question than I am. So I'm sorry that I don't want to jump into that and say something incorrect.
Yeah, very wise. Somebody asks who actually writes the executive orders? Is it right? The White House staff? Is it the Department of Justice? Who it does?
I wondered that myself. The way that they're presented, in theory, the president writes them. My first thought, three sentences in, was that there was no way that was possible given current circumstances. But my guess is that yes, that they're being written by a variety of people behind the scenes. So, and I don't know if they're influenced by the cabinet or others, but they seem very policy driven. So, but there's no authors other than the president are actually given attribution in them. So we're not sure.
Somebody asked a very interesting question, which was, is it better for an executive order to be canceled by another executive order, or should the suit go through the legal process? Or I guess, is it an option for both things to happen?
Oh, that's a really great question. I don't know what so if it goes through, the advantage, I guess, to me is if the executive order stands and this lawsuit moves forward and is successful, then you really have, then you've got the force of law from a different perspective. So you've got an actual response to that from the courts versus having just an executive order canceled by another executive order. Legally, I don't know that there's any difference, but I feel like it would say something more strongly about what our country stands for if they went through the court process and won. But that's assuming they win. And again, in 2020, I'm not making any assumptions, so we'll see.
So should there be a change of administration, and should the next administration wish to rescind this executive order? How long does it take to do that?
These things are literally printed, like they come out every day in the Federal Register. So if we had a new president on day one, they could write an executive order striking this executive order moot. It takes whatever time it takes for them to come up with a proper response that, you know, addresses all of the issues in a comprehensive way, and then to print it. So it could happen quickly.
Okay, interesting. Someone else asks about the Earl Lewis talk the other day, which I guess you've heard and many others have heard. He talked about building communities of grace to make us resilient in these kind of times and with our traditional institutions. So this may not be an answerable question, but how do we get beyond the typical process of training and create opportunities for real change? How do all these legal things go hand in hand, or don't they, with the idea of communities of grace, which is a much more kind of elegant and metaphysical term?
Yeah, I think they can go hand in hand. I wish they didn't have to, right? In a perfect world, if those communities of grace were, if we had more of them and those values were espoused more frequently, you wouldn't need the force of law to try to get you to do the right thing. I think one of the challenges is that the work is hard. Equity, diversity, building an inclusive organization means that you have to really be willing to examine everything about the way you've been set up, look at your systems, figure out if there has been unintentional bias, and then be willing to confront it and do something about it. And that is hard work. So, I think really what we need, whether or not this executive order stands, is more people in higher levels of administration who are willing to do more than just have the conversation, are willing to do more than just post a statement that is anti-racist on their website or their policy page. I think they need to be willing to say, here's what I'm doing within my institution. We are looking at this thing. We are changing this process. We are changing how we do things. And then be willing to be held accountable for those things and maybe share out what the work that they're doing.
I was going to ask you if there are any role models you can think of where something like this has been achieved.
Oh, that's such a great question. I can't think of any specific place where it's been achieved 100%, but I know, I listened to a keynote the other day by a professor from Cornell University, which made me then go look at the work that they're doing there. And their website has a really comprehensive plan about how they're tackling this this issue from an administrative standpoint, how they're engaging more with the student body, how they're engaging with faculty. And I was really impressed with the thoughtfulness of their approach and the inclusiveness of just the approach as well. So I would say maybe go check out Cornell University's work in this area. I think it's quite good.
Thank you. And I think we're just going to entertain one last question, which I also wondered, what about the creation of local committees or discussion groups dedicated to conversations about these, but they're not training? Are we okay with those? I mean, is there any way around this executive order?
Well, yeah, and I think, yes, I think that that's is a good option, because if it's almost like grassroots work, right? And if it's not training, and if it can't be if it doesn't look like training, and you're not, it's not being presented by a federal contractor and or it's not being funded by federal funds, then you are free to do these things in whatever way that you like. So, and I think those conversations are really good and key, because that's really the first step. I know that I and many others have said, show me more than your statement on your website, but it does require conversation and work to get these things going. So I think that's a really good approach.
Okay. There was a comment here saying that Cornell is offering training in this area to alums for a fee, but still is, you know, goes with what you just said.
Well, that's
fantastic. Nancy, I think we're going to have to halt this conversation for now.
Yeah.
continue it elsewhere. It's too bad we're not in the corridors of the Francis Marion, but maybe we will be next year. And thank you so very much.
You're very welcome. Thank you.
Next, it's a privilege for me to introduce Pam Samuelson, who's another person that I deeply admire, but I've had the chance to admire her for much longer because I've known her for a lot longer. Somebody who has made, I think, tremendous influence on the way we think about intellectual property law. She is the Richard Sherman Distinguished Professor of Law at the University of California at Berkeley and a co-director of the Berkeley Center for Law and Technology. She's written and spoken extensively about the challenges that new information technology pose for traditional legal regimes and particularly intellectual property law. She's the co-founder and president of the Authors Alliance. She's a member of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences, a fellow of the Association for Computing Machinery, a past fellow of the John D. and Catherine T. MacArthur Foundation. And we heard John Palfrey's keynote where he described that MacArthur Genius program. And she's an honorary professor at the University of Amsterdam. She's also chair of the board of directors of the Electronic Frontier Foundation. She joined the Berkeley faculty in 1996 after serving as a professor at the University of Pittsburgh Law School. Her topic today is also of pressing interest to all of us, controlled digital lending in the context of the publisher's lawsuit against the Internet Archive. So Pam, thank you for joining us.
Well, thanks for the invitation to speak to you today. Good day to everyone. I did provide a set of slides and they are available, I think, on the website for this conference. But because I don't know about you, but I get tired of looking at slides, I decided to just speak to you. So I hope that's okay. So here's where we're going. I'm gonna talk first about what is controlled digital lending. I'm gonna talk a little bit about institutions and people who have endorsed this. There's a position statement on controlled digital lending and a white paper that actually explains what the rationale is for controlled digital lending. I'm gonna talk about the Authors Alliance support for CDL as a fair use. I'll talk a little bit about the Internet Archives Open Library as an example of CDL, and then I'll talk about the lawsuit, give you a kind of status report about it, and then talk a little bit about is it fair use, or is it not fair use, talk about risk mitigation strategies so that you might feel more comfortable doing CDL with some kinds of materials than other kinds of materials, et cetera. So that's kind of where we're going, okay? So what is controlled digital lending? There is a position statement and a white paper that's available on a website called controlleddigitallending.org. It basically makes the case for saying that it's fair use for libraries to lend digital copies of books from print versions in their collections as long as they exercise care. So what does exercise care mean? Libraries can lawfully, CDL says that you got to own a copy of a print book. You can digitize that for the purpose of digital lending. You only lend as many copies digitally as you have in your print collection. So you maintain what's called a loan to owned ratio. So if you own two copies of a print book, you can lend two digital copies in your CDL library. And you lend to one person at a time and for a limited period of time, not forever. You also use digital rights management technologies, the same kind of DRM that actually publishers use for their eBooks. So you are trying to make sure that actually no unauthorized copies or distribution of copies is going to happen as a result of that. So that's the CDL exercise care type of thing. So there are about 50 institutions right now that have endorsed CDL. That includes numerous state universities, including my institution, UC Berkeley. A number of private universities also, including Duke University Library, the Boston, San Francisco, and Los Angeles public libraries are endorsers of CDL. ARL and Spark are also institutional supporters of it. Authors Alliance, again, I'll talk about that in a minute. And about 115 individual persons have endorsed CDL too, including me, some other law professors, some library professionals, and some scholarly communications officers. So you can see the whole list of all the people who have endorsed CDL on the controldigitallending.org website. And there are even something called the a controlled digital lending implementers group. So if you are kind of like, I don't know what to do, you can actually try to get some advice from the CDL implementers. Many libraries, both in the US and in Canada, are doing CDL, even if they don't call it CDL. So one example is HathiTrust. It's emergency temporary access service is actually a CDL-like service. Project Reshare at Stanford is another of the institutions that is doing something CDL-like. Now let me talk a little bit about Authors Alliance. Now, Authors Alliance is a nonprofit organization that represents the interests of authors who want their works to be widely available. They want to take advantage of the opportunities that the internet provides for sharing more cultural resources. And we've been in existence for going on 6 years now. So and we have a newsletter, we have a blog, we have published guides to help with rights reversions, terminations of transfer, guides about fair use, guides about negotiating publishing contracts and the like. And we do policy advocacy. So we actually have filed briefs in some of the major cases in this space. So the Georgia State Copyright Online Reserve case was actually one in which we said, hey, we're academic authors. We actually want our works to be available. And putting one chapter of a book up on a course reserve seems like fair use to us. Most of the challenged uses in the Georgia State case actually have now been deemed fair use. So that's actually a really good thing. Okay, so that's a little bit about Authors Alliance. Please look at the website. We offer a lot of really good advice and information about what's going on in copyright and digital information spaces. So the Internet Archive since 2006 has actually been operating something called the Open Library. It has a website. It owns physical copies of the book. It digitizes those to lend. And users can browse by category and search for particular books. You can check out those books for up to 2 weeks. If you want a book that isn't available right now because it's been checked out by somebody else, you can get on a wait list. Each of the copies of these books that are in copyright is protected by DRM technologies. There are about 1.5 million books in Open Library right now. And last month, Open Library had about 7 million unique visitors. 80 libraries are actually participants in the Open Library project, and 30 actually have joined since the lawsuit by Hachette. So that's an interesting thing to know. So what is the Hachette lawsuit against Internet Archive? I think it was precipitated by Internet Archive's decision to just lift the loan-to-owned ratio. So anybody during a pandemic, all the libraries were closed. So people actually wanted to be able to get access to some reading materials, and Internet Archive decided that this was an emergency. And so it responded, and so did Hachette. Now, because controlled digital lending by Internet Archive has been going on since 2006, I guess it's a little bit of a surprise that they are now not just attacking the National Emergency Library, but also controlled digital lending altogether. So four publishers are actually the plaintiffs in this case. They're suing for a direct infringement of the reproduction and distribution right, but also for contributory infringement and for inducing infringement by others. They're claiming willful infringement of copyright. They're asking for statutory damages, which some of you may know, it can start at $750 per infringed work and can go up to $150,000 per infringed work. And they're asking for an injunction and destruction of all of the books in the open library that are in copyright. So that's it. The case was filed in June. It's not going to be resolved anytime soon. So one of the things that you folks out there have to decide, are you going to try controlled digital lending? Or are you going to just say, well, I got to wait until the lawsuit's over? Well, the lawsuit's not going to be over for years. Okay, so you have to like make a decision relatively soon. So here's what Hachette's argument is. Okay, they lay it out in their complaint, which is available on the internet in case you want to take a look at it. They basically say, look, Internet Archive is a commercial entity. It's not really, it's a nonprofit, and it's behaving like a library and archive, but that's one of the things that they allege. They say it's not one of, what Open Library does is not one of the favored uses that fair use covers. And again, Internet Archive is gonna challenge that, but nevertheless, this is what they say. Also, they say that it's non-transformative. Those of you who kind of spend time in fair use land know that if something's transformative, that means it's more likely to be fair use, but it's definitely the case that lots of non-transformative uses are actually fair, so don't get freaked out by that. The nature of the work, it's all kinds of work, so it doesn't, that factor doesn't, I think, really play very much of a role in their argument. Copying the whole thing is typically disfavored in fair use land, so Hachette says, and it's systematic and it's terrible. They say that it harms the market for ebooks, but also harms the market for sales of physical books because people aren't ordering books online that they might have done if the books were not available through Open Library. They also basically say, you know, Internet Archive is not really a library, so, you know, all the kind of library things should be just ignored. And that's kind of the gist of their argument. So what about fair use? Now, the Internet Archive has not, in its answer to the complaint, laid out the fair use case. So they're not on record right now about what their fair use argument is. So I'm gonna have to do it for them. So if you sort of say, well, what is the purpose and character of the use from the standpoint of someone who is in favor of CDL, you sort of say, hey, Open Library is a nonprofit library that's performing the conventional functions of libraries to enable the sharing of cultural resources. And especially, it's a good thing to do during a pandemic when physical libraries are shut. Nature of the work, most of the books in the Open Library are commercially inactive. So as you know, copyright lasts a really long time, and the commercial life of most books is maybe 3 to 5 years. So a lot of the commercially inactive books are in the collection. Nonfiction books are more likely to be fair use, and scholarly books are more likely to be fair use than perhaps fiction. And so the amount, it's the whole book. But one of the things you learn from studying fair use is that copying the whole thing is okay. It doesn't cut against fair use if it's reasonably necessary to achieve your purpose. And the argument here is that if you want to do digital lending, you basically have to copy the whole thing. In terms of harm, the argument is that digital lending of books one at a time is no more harmful to the market for books than lending in physical libraries is. And that's, I think, a really good argument. I think another thing that at least as to CDL, that Internet Archive can lean on pretty hard is that it's 14 years that Open Library has been in existence. So there's a kind of latches argument saying, if you let this thing go on for that many years, maybe you thought it was fair use and now you're kind of like, oh, during the pandemic, let's try to shut this stuff down. I think that's crazy, but you know, somebody made that judgment. The closest case that I know of that dealt with a similar issue is actually a case out of Germany. And let me talk to you about that briefly. So it's a case called, there's a publisher called Eugen Omer versus Darmstadt. Darmstadt is a university. Darmstadt basically had copies of some physical books. They digitized them in order to lend them at their library, and the publisher said, hey, we're happy to license you an ebook of this particular thing, but it's illegal for you to basically digitize that book. And the German court, and then eventually the CJEU, the Court of Justice of the European Union, their Supreme Court, basically said, no, it's okay. There's an exception, even though Germany doesn't have fair use the way that we do. There was a set of exceptions in German law that authorized libraries to do that digitization. And just because you basically wanted to license the digital copy doesn't mean that what the library did was wrong. So that's a case in Germany, obviously not a precedent in the United States, but I think an interesting thing, especially because generally speaking, European copyright law is stricter than US copyright law. So to me, that is a reasonable case decided rightly. So in the United States, the case that most people who are commenting on this will talk about is called Columbia Records versus Redigi. I think some of you have had presentations about the Redigi case before, but let me briefly refresh your memory. So Redigi basically was a technology company that developed a platform, the idea for which was basically if you had some music that you bought from Apple iTunes and you're basically sick of it, you can basically go to Redigi, download some software that will allow you to essentially migrate the song from your computer to the Redigi servers. And the Redigi technology basically erases that song from your computer. And then the computer, the server that Redigi offers would allow you to still play that song if you wanted to. Or you can sell it to somebody else. And Redigi basically had this very complex technology allowing people to buy and sell used music, and Columbia Records said, I don't think so. So you can see that what Redigi was trying to do is get as close to possible to being like a used bookstore or a used music store, CD store. And they tried really hard. And I think the Second Circuit Court of Appeals got to recognize that they were doing in good faith something that they thought approximated. what we call first sale rights to basically lend books, sell books, and or sell music. And so the court basically decided that the idea that this is that by purchasing the songs from Apple, that you had the right to resell it. No, because you have to make a copy of the song in order to basically resell it. And the first sale doctrine doesn't cover making copies. It only covers distributing physical copies. But the court held open the possibility that it could be a fair use under some circumstances. Now, in respect of Redigi, the court said, no, it's not fair use because you're a commercial entity and you're directly competing with Columbia Records for the sale of music. And so that's just not kosher. You can't do it. Now I think Hachette is gonna say, oh, you see, there's no digital exhaustion and fair use is really hard to do. And they'll make an argument that will try to make this seem as much like Redigi as possible. But I think it's fair to say that Internet Archive is a nonprofit library. It has a much stronger fair use argument than Redigi did. And libraries that have made huge investments in purchasing physical books have already paid the publisher for the value of that book, and if you can digitally lend it, I don't see any harm to the market. So that's what the fair use argument kind of looks like, both pro and con. And let me talk now for a few minutes about risk management strategies. So one thing you can do is if you kind of are not willing to go all out for CDL is you can basically say, hey, I will do this. I will digitally lend some kinds of materials and not others. So that's what a number of the libraries are doing, is they're making, you know, judgments based on types of materials. So very common to use CDL for special collections and things like ephemera. So posters of a certain historical period and the like. Some basically say, okay, I'm only gonna do it for scholarly books, scholarly monographs. I will do it for books that are not commercially active. You can limit who gets access. So the easiest thing to do that's completely legal, at least as the courts have found, is to lend to print disabled people so that they can get access to Braille or other kinds of, reading by talking availability. You can limit it to only registered users where not everybody gets access to it. You can limit also the kind of access. So, I think the Internet Archive is basically allowing you to download. Those downloaded copies will basically disappear after a period of time. But HathiTrust, for example, is allowing you to browse but not to download. So that's another kind of risk mitigation strategy. You can vary how long digital lens can last. And again, libraries are choosing different time periods for different kinds of materials. And you can also basically say, hey, it's a pandemic. So during a pandemic, I can do this. Floods, other kinds of disasters could be a basis for deciding to do it. And one thing you probably need to know is that you're gonna have to invest in a secure infrastructure if you wanna do something like this. There are libraries out there that can help you do this. That's what that implementers group may be useful for. But those are at least some of the risk mitigation strategies you can do. Also, it's really important to know that for any public library and for any state-related library or institution, there's the 11th Amendment of the US Constitution. Now you just sort of say, hey, 11th Amendment, why do I care? Well, under the Supreme Court's jurisprudence, the 11th Amendment to the US Constitution means no monetary compensation in lawsuits can be rendered against state-related institutions, public institutions of all kinds. No money damages can be awarded. So, yeah, you might be enjoined if eventually held liable, but you can't. Statutory damages, actual damages, none of that's available to state-related institutions. And the Supreme Court in the Allen versus Cooper case just basically said, we're sticking with our interpretation of the 11th Amendment. So Allen versus Cooper, if you want to look it up. Although copyright owners can ask for statutory damages, Section 504 C2 actually provides the courts with discretion to reduce statutory damages to zero if a nonprofit library had a reasonable belief that what it was doing was fair use. So those two things, I think, should provide at least a little bit of comfort if you want to kind of go in the CDL direction. Final thoughts here. The pandemic has closed libraries all over the country. I can't even go to the University of California, Berkeley campus, let alone go to libraries. So if I'm going to get access to a book, my God, it's going to have to be through CDL. So CDL is enabling many libraries to fulfill their missions by making books and other cultural resources available to their users. Even when physical libraries reopen, many patrons may still have conditions that make them vulnerable to COVID-19 and not feel comfortable being able to go to those physical libraries. And so CDL will allow you to continue to serve those folks. The Hachette lawsuit is obviously testing whether controlled digital lending is lawful or not. As I said, it's probably going to be 5 years, could even be 10 years before we know the answer to that question. So you're going to have to decide something in the meantime. I support the fair use defense here, as do many others. And even if the Internet Archive loses, it could be a narrow loss. Other libraries that essentially do undertake some of the risk strategies that I was talking about may be in better shape to withstand a legal challenge. But if you were trying to decide what to do, I do recommend looking at the controldigitallending.org website, see the position statement, read the white paper, make a decision for yourself, talk with other libraries that are doing it, but don't let the Hachette lawsuit basically scare you off. That's it.
Thank you, Pam. Well, we have a number of questions and comments. We're not going to get through all of them this time, just as we didn't quite with Nancy. So the Charleston organizers have got to figure out what to do with this embarrassment of great information and curiosity about it. I don't know where to start. Here's a very practical question. Does the Internet Archive have great lawyers? Are they commercial lawyers who specialize in this area? Is there a whole cohort of volunteers such as yourself offering some defense for free? How does that work? Because this could be a very expensive and not only protracted, but very expensive case.
So the answer is they've got great lawyers. So the Electronic Frontier Foundation, on whose board I serve for 20 years, is part of the legal team for this. Joe Gratz from the Dury Changri firm is one of the absolutely top copyright lawyers in the country. The legal talent there is really high. So I wouldn't worry about having bad lawyers. Obviously, bad lawyers can basically screw stuff up. But I really trust the people who are defending this case. I think they will do a really excellent job. So, but that doesn't mean that everybody should just like stand back. I think getting more people to basically stand up for CDL, endorse the CDL position statement, and undertake at least some CDL. As I said, some libraries are basically doing that. 30 of the 80 libraries that are participants in Open Library are basically joined since the lawsuit was started. So somebody's not scared, and I'm really happy about that.
So what do you think of the argument that the Internet Archive isn't a library as such? How do we think about that? Is it or isn't, what is it that makes it a library or not?
So I think, again, you can take a look at the answer that that Internet Archive filed to the complaint that Hachette filed against it. And they basically say, look, we own physical books, we lend, we're a nonprofit. We do the same kind of thing that that conventional libraries do. And we've been holding ourselves out as a library. We've gotten funding from various agencies, state and federal, as a library. And so one of the things that libraries can do is basically say, hey, Internet Archive is like us. The fact that ARL basically recently endorsed controlled digital lending, and I think is willing to sort of support the notion that that Internet Archive is a library is something that, you know, the statute doesn't define what a library is. So courts have the power to basically decide that it's a library. So yeah, we'll find out, but I'm cautiously optimistic that that courts will basically say it's a library. Get over it.
One of our audience just wanted a clarification. Is Hachette asking for a remedy of destruction of the e-files or the books themselves or both?
As I sort of read the complaint, it is to destroy the digital copies. Now, one of the things actually that I'll note here, and this came up actually also in the Authors Guild versus HathiTrust case, and that is that that I do not believe that Hachette has standing to seek a remedy against all of the books in the open library, right? Obviously, all the books that are out of copyright, they can't do anything about. So there's that. But also, you're only entitled to a remedy for your own copyrights. So Hachette doesn't own the copyrights in all of the 1.5 million books that are in the open library. So I filed a brief actually in the HathiTrust case on behalf of Authors Alliance, basically saying, look, the Authors Guild is asking for a destruction of 7 million books in copyright books in the HathiTrust repository. But it only owns 116 copyrights in those books. You don't have standing to basically represent the interests of all copyright owners, unless it's a class action, which in that Authors Guild case, it wasn't. And so you don't have standing, right? So you may be able, now all the books that are actually were complained about in Open Library have already been taken down. And that's one of the policies that, again, you might want to think about as a mitigation strategy, which is that if you put it up and then the rights holder comes and says, hey, I don't want you to do this digital lend, you can take it down. And that's what's happened here. So in some sense, the lawsuit's going on about other books that they don't have standing for. So they could get kicked out of court on standing grounds, which I think would be great. And there are actually two Second Circuit cases basically saying, You can only get a remedy against a defendant as to your own copyrights, not to anybody else's.
Okay. I think we have time to explore one more question. And somebody says you used the term commercially active. How would one define that? And then another person commented that a book could be commercially available electronically, but it could be at such a price that it may be commercially active, but it may just be beyond the pale for the user or the institution. So how do we think about commercially active in this context?
Well, again, it's obviously a continuum. We used to be able to say a book was out of print, and we knew what that meant. And we don't have those same metrics these days, and that's too bad. But there are some books, I would say scholarly monographs are a good example of something that even if there might be three sales of the book a year, it's just not a commercially active book. So you'd have to, again, it would be part of a risk management strategy to sort of say, you know, okay, if it's a bestseller on the New York Times list, that's definitely something we're not going to do a digital end of, even though we might want to, right? But books that are less commercially active, that are more nonfiction, that are more scholarly, again, it's a risk mitigation strategy. Publishers will tell you nothing is commercially inactive anymore, but that's not really true, and they know it.
Okay. Thank you for that. We have to conclude our discussion about both of these topics now because we're handing off to Leah Hines for the conclusion of this session. And I hope we will have the opportunity in future Long Arm of the Law sessions and other Charleston venues to continue with these topics, Leah. So over to Leah Hines.
Thank you very much, Anne, and to Nancy and Pam for that wonderful panel. Another successful year of Long Arm of the Law. We just wanted to take a few moments here at the end. Anne already mentioned that we tragically lost Bill Hannay this year. He has been a panelist for the Long Arm of the Law session since it began. We were talking just before the session. I was thinking he was here all 10 years, but he actually did miss being in Charleston 1 year due to an emergency surgery that happened like the day before he was due to go on stage. He was so dedicated that he gave a copy of his presentation to his friend, Bruce Strauch, who is Katina's husband and also an attorney. And Bruce delivered his presentation in his stead. So that is real dedication. But he would traditionally close his talk each year with an original performance, a song that he wrote a parody on the topic of his presentation. So this song that we're going to play in memoriam to him was performed at the 2017 Charleston Conference, where he was speaking then about the Redigi case and Google and some other topics. But it is a parody of the song You Don't Own Me that was originally performed by Leslie Gore in 1963. So I hope that you will enjoy this performance and we can remember Bill with a smile the way he would want us to, and we'll close the session at the end of the performance. Thank you very much.
And so what more is there to be said? So we've heard from the recording and publishing industries, from copyright scholars, from libraries. Who have we not heard from? Well, the answer is the digital media itself. So I've gone and I've interviewed a musical medium, and that we're now going to hear. You don't own me. I'm not just one of your normal books. You don't own me. I'm licensed only for Kindles and Nooks. So don't try to retail me. Don't think I'm physical. And please, if you try by selling me. Don't forget I'm digital, 'cause you don't own me. Don't try to change me in any way. You don't own me. Don't transfer me, 'cause you'd have to pay. I don't tell you what to play. I don't tell you what to read. Please observe my right of way. That's the thing that you agreed. I'm code, and I love to be code at ease, 'cause I'll never unfreeze. Don't think I'm in some transfer mode. You can't do whatever you please. Everybody now, you know. I'm not just one of your normal books. You don't own me. I'm licensed only for Kindles and Nooks. Get ready now. So don't try to retail me. Don't think I'm physical. And please, when you try selling me, don't forget I'm digital.
That's pretty good.